Dear ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to speak to you about non-invasive imaging of stable coronary artery disease after the ESC guidelines. What is meant by this are the ESC guidelines on chronic coronary syndromes, which Schlüpfer published approximately a year ago in the year 2019. My name is Stefan Achenbach from the University of Erlangen in Germany, and CT imaging, as you will see a little bit later, is one of my focus areas. So I'll put in a little note about cardiac CT here and there, because cardiac CT has become a new focus a little bit of these non-invasive imaging aspects of imaging in chronic coronary syndromes. But before I start going through the details, I would like to start with three relatively basic considerations that it's good to make ourselves aware of. Number one, what is it that we want to know in patients who have suspected coronary artery disease? Well, on one hand, we want to know whether the symptoms the patients are complaining of are caused by ischemia. And if we think about coronary angiography in revascularization, we specifically want to know whether these symptoms might be relieved by revascularization. The second question, of course, when patients are complaining of chest pain, we want to know whether these patients are at increased risk for myocardial infarction and or death, and whether revascularization or medication with statins and aspirin might reduce that risks. So these are the two different questions we want answered. A, are the patient's symptoms caused by ischemia and can they be relieved by medication and mainly also revascularization? And B, is the patient at increased risk for myocardial infarction and death? In order to get oriented about whether symptoms might be attributable to coronary artery disease, amenable to revascularization, typically what we're looking for are stenosis, narrowings of the coronary arteries, even though we know that looking and finding for stenosis is not necessarily enough, because quite a few stenosis look relatively high grade but do not cause necessarily ischemia. So typically a correlation of stenosis on one hand and ischemia on the other is needed before we know that a given atherosclerotic lesion in the coronary arteries causes stenosis, will benefit from revascularization. As far as the risk for events is concerned, even looking for stenosis is not enough, because as you all know, and probably who have completely normal or almost normal coronary arteries on one day, and then as this patient 4 days later experienced myocardial infarction, acute coronary syndrome caused by plaque rupture. The plaques that rupture are not necessarily high-grade stenosis. They can be relatively minor. And then suddenly the acute coronary symptoms occurs without underlying high-grade stenosis, and often in many patients without any preceding symptoms. Based on the data from the mid and early 90s, we know that about 70% of myocardial infarctions are caused by lesions which angiographically in the weeks before the infarct do not have an appearance of a high-grade stenosis, but appear to be less than a 50% stenosis. Because because acute coronary syndromes are caused by the rupture of atherosclerotic plaque, it might in fact be useful to visualize these plaques. And this is where CT comes in for the first time, because CT angiography allows, if image quality is sufficient, to visualize both calcified plaques. Here's one, and here's one calcified plaque, and also non-calcified plaques. And image quality is really good. We can quantify and to some extent also characterize coronary atherosclerotic lesions. And since plaques are caused by, since acute coronary syndromes are caused by plaque rupture, intuitively, this might be useful to see, detect, or rule out coronary atherosclerotic plaque by cardiac CT. In fact, there is some data that indirectly indicates that using CT to work up patients with suspected coronary artery disease might be beneficial. Most frequently cited is the Scott Hart trial, 4,200 patients with suspected coronary artery disease in Scotland. They were randomized to receive as the first diagnostic test either coronary CT angiography or standard of care. The standard of care in most cases was exercise EKG testing, not the standards that you have in the US mainly, where ischemia imaging, SPECT, for example, is often used as the first test. Anyways, these patients were worked up either by CT or by exercise testing. And it turns out that after 5 years, the rate of non-fatal myocardial infarction in the standard of care arm, 3.9%, was significantly higher than in the CT angiography arm, 2.3%. Low event rates overall, as usual in these studies, but the question is why? The test itself doesn't change anything. So what was the consequence of this initial test that might have contributed to the difference in myocardial infarction incidence? And we can see, based on the analysis of this trial, that in patients who underwent CT, preventive medication, aspirin and statins, was started more frequently, 14% of patients, than in patients who underwent the standard of care, mostly exercise testing, only 4% of patients. And it was also stopped more frequently, probably because CT demonstrated the absence of plaque. This is a little bit speculation, because treatment was left to individual decision in this trial where only the first diagnostic test was randomized, but the trial suggests that possibly the ability of CT to visualize plaque and to initiate or terminate risk-modifying therapy based on the study result might have contributed to the decreased risk of myocardial infarction in the group of patients who were randomized to coronary CT angiography. A second basic consideration is, as we think about testing, non-invasive testing for coronary artery disease, how accurate are our tests? How accurate are our tests, the non-invasive tests, to find patients who have coronary artery disease? And of course, we repeatedly see studies that look at the accuracy of these tests. It's a little difficult because comparing an ischemia test to invasive angiography, you compare the detection of ischemia to the presence of stenosis. So these test results also have to be taken with a grain of salt. But here is one very recent example, which compared in a large cohort of almost 800 patients, magnetic resonance stress imaging combined with late enhancement, function and rest imaging, so a complete magnetic resonance protocol, compared this to invasive angiography, and mainly based on the identification of stress perfusion defects, found a sensitivity of 79% and a specificity of 87% to identify stenosis of 70% or more in the invasive angiogram. Sensitivity approximately 80, specificity 87% for stress myocardial and magnetic resonance imaging. And similar comparisons, of course, are available for all kinds of tests. The guidelines that I mentioned at the beginning undertook a review of the available evidence as far as accuracy is concerned for the non-invasive tests. And you can see exercise EKG has a poor sensitivity and a good specificity. Counterintuitively, often we assume the opposite. But in unbiased trials, sensitivity is low and specificity is pretty good. PET, of course, has excellent sensitivity and specificity, and excellent means about 85%. SPECT also in the 70 to 85% region. Stress echo around 85%. Stress MR, as we just saw, about 90% sensitivity, 80% specificity. If you take the pooled available data, the recent trial had better specificity but lower sensitivity. Coronary CTA, 96% sensitivity, 82% specificity. In general, you can say that if these studies performed by experts, the sensitivity and specificity, of course, will range from patient to patient, but will be approximately in the 85% range. That's probably a reasonable assumption, potentially with the exception that the sensitivity of coronary CTA is close to 100%. But 85% seems to be a reasonable value. This is how accurate our tests are to find patients with coronary artery disease based on non-invasive testing. And a third basic consideration, which at first seems almost ridiculous to ask, is testing always useful? Is testing always contributing towards knowing more about the patient? Or other way of phrasing this is, after the test, do we know more about the patient's condition than before the test? Typically, we would assume yes, but is this really the case? When we see a patient who has complaints, for example, a patient who complains of chest pain, and we think, does this patient have coronary artery disease? We typically estimate a pre-test likelihood. Before performing any other test, we try to assign a likelihood to this patient. Definitely, this is something, probably, I don't think so. So we give the patient something on a spectrum continuity of likelihood that the patient may or may not have disease. And typically then the next idea is to perform a test in any disease. It can be a blood test, it can be an imaging test, or whatever other test. And the idea is that, in general, if I perform a test, I will know more about the patient after the test than I did before the test. The test will give me a clearer picture. The test will give me a better estimation of the likelihood that this patient has disease. So conventional thinking that we all typically do is that after a test, the likelihood of disease assigned to a given patient is closer to reality than before the test. So we conclude that typically testing will be helpful, but is this really the case? We have to consider that no test is 100% accurate. And we still typically assume that even if a test is not 100% accurate, there's probably still some value to the test. But let's look at a hypothetical group of patients who have coronary artery disease. And we know that our tests for obstructive coronary artery disease, our non-invasive tests, have a sensitivity and specificity of approximately 85%, which means that 85% of test results will be correct and about 15% of test results will be incorrect. So now let's look at a large group now of 1,100 patients, 100 of which have disease. We have 100 patients with disease. We have a sensitivity of 85%. So 85 of these 100 patients will be detected and 15% will be incorrectly classified as not having disease. 85 correct, 15 incorrect. We have 1,000 patients without disease. So with a specificity of 85%, we will identify 850 correctly as healthy and 150 will incorrectly be classified as having disease, even though they do not. Specificity 85%. If we sum this up, we will have a total of 935 patients with a correct diagnosis and 165 patients with an incorrect classification. However, had we simply assumed that all patients are healthy, we would have 1,000 patients classified correctly and only 100 patients classified incorrectly. So you can see that performing a test classifies fewer patients correctly than we would have classified correctly had no test been performed. Sometimes, as a result of performing a test, the assessment of the patient after the test is worse than it was before. This is true in particular for very high and very low pretest likelihoods. Or as a consequence, the value of diagnostic testing depends on the pretest likelihood. Sometimes it may actually be better to not use any test. And it also depends on how the test performs in patient cohorts with low, intermediate, and high prevalence of disease. So the three very basic considerations: what do we want to know in patients with suspected coronary artery disease? We want to know about whether the symptoms are caused by coronary disease and how the prognosis of the patient is. How accurate are our tests to find patients with coronary artery disease? In general, approximately 85%. And is testing always useful? Not necessarily. In very low and very high pretest likelihood situations, performing a test might potentially give us a worse estimation of the patient's true likelihood of having disease than if no test had been performed. So now back to the guidelines. The 2019 ESC guidelines for the diagnosis and management of chronic coronary syndromes, they start with pretest likelihood, and they show us that even patients presenting with relatively typical symptoms, even in patients at somewhat higher age, the pretest likelihood for having coronary artery disease is not extremely high. Typical atypical non-angular chest pain, 70-year-old male, non-angular chest pain, pretest likelihood 22%. They also list dyspnea as a possible symptoms, and the likelihood assigned with dyspnea is approximately the same as that with atypical symptoms. Notably, the guidelines point out that the availability of information about multiple risk factors in a patient, the presence of an abnormal EKG, and importantly also wall motion abnormalities in echocardiography, here you can see an anterior wall motion problem, will significantly change the pretest likelihood assigned to the patient. The likelihood of coronary disease is modified substantially if there's an abnormal EKG, if there's a wall motion abnormality in echocardiography. And this is why the guidelines say that in every patient with suspected coronary artery disease, with suspected chronic coronary artery disease, arresting TTE should be performed. This is a class one recommendation, should be done to look at alternative diagnosis, aortic stenosis and other diseases, to look at identification of regional wall motion abnormalities that increase the likelihood for coronary artery disease, and to also measure left ventricular ejection fraction. So the guidelines point out that you assess the pretest likelihood based on gender, age, and the nature of symptoms, but a normal exercise EKG will decrease the likelihood. An abnormal exercise EKG will increase the likelihood. Left ventricular dysfunction will increase the likelihood. Risk factors for cardiovascular disease will increase the likelihood. For all of this, there are no numbers, but it needs to be sort of integrated in the physician's estimate of how high the patient's pretest likelihood for having coronary artery disease actually is. And then a spectrum of tests is available that can be chosen. Imaging stress tests, such as SPECT, stress echo, or stress CMR, CT angiography, and we know that all of these tests have accuracies in the about 80 to 85% range. Stress EKG is not recommended because the sensitivity is relatively low. The guidelines emphasize that revascularization should usually not be done based on a single test alone. Even if you perform invasive angiography, FFR should be done to assess the presence of a high-grade stenosis if no ischemia test is available, unless a stenosis is more than 90%. If you do CT angiography as a test, then stress testing needs to be done to demonstrate whether the lesion seen here actually causes ischemia. Alternative, you can go to invasive angiography and perform FFR or IFR. And finally, even if you perform non-invasive testing for ischemia, then the next test will have to be coronary angiography, potentially also with FFR and IFR added if there are multiple stenoses seen and it's not completely clear which stenosis of these causes ischemia and which does not. The guidelines suggest a system that actually makes it clear that often more than one test will be needed to get complete information. And the patient can enter this system of several tests at various points. Patients can go to coronary CTA, patients can go to non-invasive testing for ischemia, and some patients even to invasive coronary angiography as the first test. Invasive coronary angiography only in few patients, preferentially considered in those who have very high clinical likelihood and typical symptoms refractory to medical therapy. There it might make sense, especially if there's also left ventricular dysfunction suggestive of coronary artery disease, to move immediately to invasive angiography. This is what the guidelines say. Coronary CTA preferentially considered if there's a relatively low clinical likelihood that the patient has disease, but also if the patient has characteristics that promise high image quality, local expertise is available, and a high-end CT scanner can be used. And finally, non-invasive testing for ischemia, preferentially considered in those who have a relatively high clinical likelihood of finding disease, and particularly when there's a wall motion problem in echocardiography, so that the physician also wants to know about viability, because the non-invasive testing for ischemia typically also includes viability imaging, which is important information when proceeding to invasive angiography. If an stenosis of more than 90% is found in invasive angiography, or if a stenosis is found that has an established correlation to ischemia, either based on non-invasive testing or based on invasive FFR, then revascularization would be indicated. This is another way in which the guidelines display this choice of testing that is available to the physician. No testing in very low pretest likelihood situations, potentially immediately invasive angiography with the availability of FFR or IFR in the very high pretest likelihood. And in between, you can choose either coronary CTA or testing for ischemia, SPECT, stress MR, stress echocardiography. And the choice of test is based on the clinical likelihood that the patient has disease, on patient characteristics and also patient preference, on the availability of a test, and also importantly, on local expertise. It is new in these guidelines that coronary CTA is labeled as the preferred test in patients who have a low range of clinical likelihood, no previous diagnosis of coronary artery disease because it's difficult to image patients who already have stents, for example, and who have characteristics associated with a high likelihood of good image quality, typically meaning relatively low heart rate, definitely irregular heart rate, and the absence of severe obesity. It is in fact interesting because this is something new for guidelines. Guidelines will typically always, you know, say thing is good or thing is bad. But here these guidelines on chronic coronary syndromes, I think very reasonably say that the test should really only be selected if a patient characteristics allows to expect high image quality for this given test. And also importantly, if there is local expertise. In coronary CTA, in order to achieve good image quality, the prerequisites are regular and low heart rate. Often the heart rate is even lowered further for the test itself by giving beta blockers and the absence of substantial obesity. Just a word on follow-up testing. In patients with established coronary artery disease, the guidelines recommend periodic echocardiography after a revascularization is performed after 1 to 3 months, and then possibly 1 year later and every 3 or 5 years after that. Stress testing for inducible ischemia can be performed when patients report changes in symptoms, and also it potentially to do it periodically every 3 to 5 years to reassess the presence of ischemia. So in summary, with current technology and knowledge about test performance, there's a high degree of freedom in choosing the initial tests in patients who have suspected coronary artery disease. You should make it dependent on pretest likelihood and also on patient characteristics, local expertise, availability, and patient preference. From what I said in the beginning, the ability of CT to not only rule in or rule out stenosis, but to also visualize plaque might allow improved identification of at-risk individuals, but there's no really hard data available on this as of yet, what the detection of plaque in CT means, for example, for the initiation of statin therapy. Importantly, one single test might not be enough. It might be necessary to image both morphology and ischemia. A sequence of tests might be appropriate. And invasive angiography should be regarded as a test and not as an automatic route to PCI. Unless stenosis of more than 90% are present, the demonstration of ischemia associated with the stenosis, either by FFR or by non-invasive testing, is required before proceeding to revascularization. With this, I would like to thank you very much for your attention, and thank you once again for being part of this presentation.